These were very interesting films. The last one in particular was great, as you said. So one thing that puzzled me is that while I was watching was that we feel we have been told that maths is every time more important in our present world in the application science, computer science and the markets and everything we have heard, even in applications. So how come we constantly hear parents saying that, well, okay, you are no good at maths, that's no problem. I also always hated math, and that's okay. So it would be very offensive to hear something like that about, I don't know, music or literature or poetry. So how come we accept this, we find it acceptable with respect to maths?
This is a good question, which for some reason in almost every developed country people are convinced that it is specific to their country and that in the other countries things are better. But I can tell you it's exactly the same everywhere. And it shows that finding normal to be out of the science and technological world is something which is universal, something which is normal. There are some good reasons and some bad reasons for that. Certainly one good reason is that doing science, doing math, is not a natural activity. Talking, telling stories, speaking, singing, all these are natural activities. I mean, human beings have been talking for several hundreds of thousands of years. It's natural, we're born with the ability to speak and or to learn language, and then we speak and so on, and in every little corner of the world, people tell stories to their children and so on, without having to learn about it. Knowledge about literature and so on, of course, then there is some element of culture, some element of work, but it's a natural development of all this. On the other hand, science and mathematics is recent. Mathematics, in the sense that we consider now, was invented in ancient Greece, so let's say it was about a bit more than 2,000 years ago. And in the even more precise sense that we use now, with the mixture of mathematics and physics that can be used in the technology, it goes essentially back to the beginning of 17th century. So it's very recent, and for a long time it was reserved to an elite. Nowadays there are many mathematicians. Jean-Pierre Bourguignon in the movie insists on the fact that in a short time, over the course of the 20th century, the number of professional mathematicians went from maybe a few thousand to a few hundreds of thousands. And this is very recent. Before that, and before the time of the education for everybody and so on, it was okay to have mathematics and more generally science reserved to a small community which was able to do the work. This is in some sense the good reason for the fact that people don't find it a problem to be completely not knowledgeable in science. Now there are also bad reasons, and bad reasons is a certain kind of view of the world in which you let the scientists and the engineers do the work alone in their corner and don't care about them. Like, these are the slaves who work for the society common good and you don't care about them. And continue to, and consider that the important thing is the rest, the more soft stuff and the more cultural, more general affairs. And this is a very bad reasons. And this kind of view is one of the, there is some element that in the background of the minds of some people, it's like this in the society. And it's one of the reasons why we have so many problems of motivation for people to do science. One has to insist that the number one problem for the future of science in this country, as in France, as in Germany, as in UK, as in United States, number one problem is to find motivated students. All the rest is a secondary problem. And everybody has understood this is a problem. Everybody in the world, they are putting up programs to motivate the young people to do science, etc. I was in England 3 days ago, and in the newspapers in the morning, I saw that the Minister of Education had made the big announcement to say, listen, people, we know that you all love the studies in literature, art, etc., but it's important that there are more of you who go into science and technology and mathematics, because this is where there is a number of jobs to be taken, and this is where we need the more people to do. And it was explicit from the Minister of Education. And immediately, of course, there were the very angry, offended reactions of people saying, it's a shame, how dare you speak like that? Culture is so important, art is so important, and the most important is to need the children to be creative, and so on. Okay, it's true, but if you don't say at some point, and if you're Minister of Education, and don't say at some point that there is a lack of jobs to be taken in the sciences, and there are not enough students going into these directions, then you are not doing your job of minister.
I remember the comment of one of those American teenagers saying that he was very frustrated with mathematics. He was good, but he didn't really enjoy it. What do you think about the question? He complains that with other things like English or writing, he can just go do that and start doing it. Whereas in mathematics, you have to learn a lot of things before having fun. What do you think, I mean, how do you rate this question of having to work very hard to put in a lot of effort to start doing fun things in mathematics?
Mm-hmm. It's partly a misconception, and I can easily transcribe your question about mathematics to, for instance, a question about music. I was telling about singing. Of course, everybody can sing, bad or good, but everybody can sing if asked to. But play the piano? Not. You cannot do some improvisation at the piano before studying years, if you want to do something interesting. So exactly that same thing you could say about practicing a musical instrument, that you could say it with mathematics. And there are many jobs, many savoir-faire, many knowledge that for which you have to practice a lot before you can really have fun. You know, if you want to play, I don't know, let's imagine we are in England and we talk about cricket. For an Englishman, of course, cricket is impossible to understand. I don't know how it is with you. No. But okay, how can you tell the kids, okay, go on and play the cricket before learning the rules and training, so to be coordinated and so on. So there are many of these things for which before you can have any fun, you need to digest the rules and practice and so on. Now, the problem with mathematics is not that. The problem is that you don't necessarily understand where is the final goal. In the end, the final goal of the cricket is maybe to have good fun and train your muscles and run and win over the other team. The goal when you are practicing the music, etc., in the end is to hear some beautiful piece of music. But where's the goal, final goal, in the practicing of mathematics? This, for many kids, is a mystery. Some kids learn very early, and depends also on how they feel it, to find it like a game, and they find their reward in just the understanding. The joy of understanding for some is enough, but for some is not enough. And so you have to tell them what will be the reward, or what they will be able to understand better after they've done this, or what the field that they are studying is good for in the end. And there we arrive at the question of where is mathematics used? What is it used for? It is a kind of new question in the sense that teachers are not prepared for such questions usually. Math teachers, when a kid asks, what is mathematics useful for? Usually we'll find this a problem to answer. And the professor, the teacher, has these rewards usually about mathematics from the general beauty, inner beauty of the course of mathematics, but doesn't think of applications that the kid can have in mind. Nowadays, we are much better prepared for this question because the industry is telling us every day, we need mathematicians, we need more mathematicians for finance, for the movie industry, of course, for everybody, everything. We need, everywhere there's technology, we need mathematicians. And we are better prepared for this question in a way.
Speaking about a little bit about your work, I've just finished yesterday your book, by the third reading, that is. it is really emotional for a mathematician to read. You describe very well the creative process, and something which there are many beautiful things, but one thing that struck me is that you speak a lot about the arts, about music, about literature, about poetry. And the way you describe the results you reach is a bit like an artist, a painter's work, an artist. So I would like to hear you on what you think are the relations between mathematics research, and art.
First of all, mathematics is a human science in the sense that it is made by human beings. One should not think that the brain of a mathematician is fundamentally different from the brain of any other being. It is true that some mathematicians are special. I don't consider myself particularly special in this respect, but I have known a few of my colleagues who are particular. But even among my colleagues, they constitute a minority. Most of my colleagues, you would have a discussion with them, and before they tell you they are mathematicians, you would not realize they are mathematicians. You would talk about movies with them, about the literature, about cartoons, about whatever. Like every human being, they like the arts, and it helps them. And like many creative people, like many people whose job is to be creative, because when you're a mathematician, your job is to create new theorems, new mathematics, they need the art also as something that stimulates the brain, something that helps you think and helps you create. And this can take any form. And we all know this when you are thinking hard about getting a new idea or something, it can be a real help to go and take a walk in a beautiful scenery. It can be useful to see a good movie. It's not just for recreation. It's also because it makes your brain, it stimulates your brain in some way which is different from what you were just doing. I wanted this aspect to be put forward in the book because I use this a lot in my work. And in general, all the environment and all the rituals, listening to some music, getting some hot cup of tea, whatever. Anybody has his or her rituals in the creative process, and this I wanted to put forward because this is not a movie about the mathematics, it's a movie about the dialogue between you and yourself and your collaborators when you are working hard on creating the new stuff. Not focusing on the result, but on the circumstances. And in these circumstances, everything that is helping you matters, including the art, which helps you. Even though in the end, it will not be apparent in the result. There is a common misconception that if you're a mathematician, necessarily you will see mathematics everywhere, number everywhere. And some people are convinced that if I listen to music, I will hear the frequencies. If I see a painting, I will see a bunch of pixels with some code or whatever. There is nothing like this, my friends. When I hear a piece of music, it's just like anybody else. I don't even have absolute pitch, so it's very emotional. My brother, who is not at all a mathematician, can recognize the notes and not me. And by the way, he's much better than me at memorizing numbers. So in terms of emotions, it is really the same, essentially the same as everybody else. Even in terms of the way of thinking, the computations. Most people think that a mathematician, among other things, is able to keep in mind long numbers, to make computations, whatever. Not at all. I once on a TV, for some TV show or something, I accepted to do some mental computation on scene. It was a disaster. I missed by a factor 10 or something like this. It was a real disaster. I have a friend, on the other hand, who holds the European record of memorization of digitals of pi. The guy, who's a bit special, by the way, and also a good writer, he has a very special way to memorize and to think about things, in his feeling, he has in his sensations, he's special in a way. But he's not a mathematician at all, in the sense that he doesn't create new mathematics. The mathematics process is much more about you need a lot of rigor, but it's much more about putting concepts together. A bit the work of a lawyer preparing some argumentation to prove that the client is guilty or something like this. Difference being that you have to be absolutely rigorous. There is no point in which you have to try to impress with compelling amount of evidence. The notion of compelling evidence does not exist in mathematics, has to be pure rigor. I'm digressing a little bit, but all this to say that in our thinking processes, in our neurobiology and so on, we are quite like everybody. Just we developed the capacity to make proofs, to think of proofs, and a lot of knowledge about the meaning and about the construction of mathematics everywhere, which for us is also art in some sense.
It was very nice to hear you saying that people think that mathematicians see numbers everywhere, where we don't. I was just commenting on your film by Lamain de Villani, that you were filling a blackboard with equations, and there was one number.
One and zero, maybe.
Yes, two. One infinity and two in the square. But so there were no numbers, there were just ideas. Would you like to?
Yes. In the end, when you go inside what is here and there, you will find numbers. For instance, I write F everywhere. At some point, it's a function, so it's an object which associates a number to a number. But I never think of it this way. For me, it's a shape, it's an object with some properties, etc. And I manipulate them as you would manipulate, I don't know, the objects of a mecano without caring which is the metal which constitutes them. In the end, it's numbers, but it's not the way I think of them. This is important. Also, while we are still on this subject about how we think, how we mathematicians think of the process. Let me add that even for those of us who are recognized as good mathematicians, excellent mathematicians, great mathematicians, the life of a mathematician is always difficult. There is no such thing as great mathematician making his theorems easily. It's always, as described in the book, by the way, a painful process to create something new, to create something rigorous, and we are always making mistakes all along the process that we are correcting progressively, first draft and then correct and correct again, sometimes small mistakes, sometimes big mistakes. It was Henri Poincaré himself, you know, he's still considered one of the references in terms of creativity and the ability to cover all of mathematics, who said, it is remarkable that we all do mistakes, even the best mathematicians do mistakes in their work. And he insists, it is a remarkable observation that it is difficult for us to make a proof, a mathematical proof, a rigorous proof. We know it's difficult because we all tried it. But for aliens from an outer space, without any feelings and observing, they could consider this kind of mystery. You see, when you are at school, you put together arguments when we are solving a small problem in geometry of triangles, which are not very complicated. Arguments like the sum of the angles of the triangle is this, and two parallel lines to a third are parallel between themselves, etc. Things like this, which are simple steps. And we suffer for putting it together. It requires an effort and we make mistakes. Well, in daily life, we do a lot of things when we are talking, for instance, recognizing emotions of the person you are talking to is a process involving a crazy number of ingredients and logical steps, much, much more complicated than the mathematical reasoning, simple mathematical reasoning, which we have so much difficulty to put together. And by the way, it's rather easy nowadays to make a robot that can make simple proofs of elementary geometry with a small number of axioms, while it's extremely difficult to construct a robot that recognizes if somebody is happy or angry. A small child can do this, but it's very difficult to formalize. And Poincaré, without entering into all these details, wonders about this. And the truth is, we humans are good at certain things for which we are born. Naturally, we are good at recognizing emotions, having empathy, talking. Writing is difficult. Writing we have to learn, and it's a real pain. But talking is so easy. Everybody likes learns to talk. Politics is very easy. I mean, even kids play games about who's the boss, I can do this alliance with you, and so on. We know that we share this aptitude to politics with the chimpanzees. And on the contrary, mathematics, this is very difficult. There is no mystery about how these kind of things came. I mean, simply there are some things which are selected by evolution and others not. And it's clear that when you are in the wild, it's very useful to recognize the emotions of the person you are interacting with. While there is no reward in the wild for mathematics, but even usually no reward for logical thinking. Rational thinking is something which arrived very late in the evolution and whose reward is almost nothing. Usually, it's much better to have irrational behavior because it makes you strong, because you think you're the best. You can go to war with irrational feelings. And when you look at how your ideas are successful, usually ideas propagate by irrational feelings much quicker than by rational discussion. And there's no, in the wild, in natural state, so to speak, irrationality is in general a much better survival strategy than rationality. But when you have the society which is constructed and technology and everything, and many people working together, then rational starts to be rewarding, because you can make weapons which are stronger, you can make artwork which is much more beautiful if you agree on the technology, if you agree on what to use, etc. So it's a recent capacity, but to rational thinking, but it's not natural.
Je voudrais, pardon, en français, en français, oui, ça va. J'ai beaucoup aimé le film sur la main de Villani. D'où est venue, pardon, oui, sa main, oui. D'où est venue cette idée de, bon, Cédric Villani est un super star, mais d'où est venue cette idée de d'avoir un film dans lequel le protagoniste était la main de Villani?
C'est-à-dire que la main de Villani, c'est Villani aussi. Donc après, l'idée... Donc j'ai rencontré Cédric Villani à l'Institut Poincaré. Et puis on a un peu parlé comme ça. Puis après, il a dessiné quelque chose sur une feuille de papier. Et donc je me suis dit, finalement, la main qui dessine l'équation, c'est la chose la plus simple qui va démontrer un ensemble de choses qui sont de plus en plus compliquées, quoi. C'est-à-dire, on a d'une part on a l'équation de Sarsignani, on a Cédric qui va résumer l'équation de Sarsignani. Ensuite, il y a quand Cédric est arrivé pour le filmage, j'ai dit à Cédric qu'il faudrait que ça ne dépasse pas plus de 6 minutes. Donc Cédric a réfléchi, on le voit réfléchir comme ça au début du film. Il se demande quelle équation il va faire, parce qu'il n'avait pas décidé de faire l'équation de Sarsignani au début. Et donc on va voir que ce petit moment de film, quoi, est à la fois du temps, de l'espace, Sarsignani, Cédric, le temps, la construction du film, le temps qu'on a mis pour filmer, parce qu'il n'y a pas de montage, il n'y a rien. Et puis ce qui est formidable dans cette histoire-là par rapport à ce que Cédric vient de dire, c'est-à-dire que les mathématiciens, c'est le seul point où les mathématiciens et les artistes se rejoignent, puisque mettons, je peux vous dire que le peintre le plus précis du monde, c'est Jackson Pollock, vous voyez. Bon, et donc si je dis ça, ça veut dire que toute la pensée qui préside à une découverte ou à un énoncé ou une équation, etc., c'est toujours très très flottant. Mais à un moment donné, ça va se préciser pas en un seul point, ça va se préciser en plusieurs points, et ces plusieurs points vont se réunir à un moment ou pas se réunir, etc. Mais ces plusieurs points peuvent se réunir aussi, comme a dit Cédric, en parlant avec d'autres mathématiciens, ou en ayant une conversation avec une femme, ou en voyant un film de Raoul Walsh, ou je sais pas quoi, et tout d'un coup, il y a des points qui se précisent, et à un moment donné, il y a quelque chose qui se réalise parce que la connexion, elle est bonne, quoi. Mais elle peut être bonne aussi peut-être dans 20 ans, ou elle peut être bonne dans 3 secondes, quoi. Personne n'en sait. Donc ce qui est intéressant dans la comparaison comme ça entre les artistes, c'est cette imprécision et ce flottement permanent qui est en réalité extrêmement précis. Mais parce que, à la limite, je sais pas, moi je peux dire que ça fait 30 ans que je cherche une sortie, mettons. Voilà. Alors donc la sortie, elle ne va pas s'exprimer avec une sortie. Elle va s'exprimer avec 50 possibilités de sortie, mais aucune n'est définitive. Mais si on regarde l'ensemble de ces 50 possibilités, là, je suis en train de parler de mathématiques, hein, de toute façon. Si on regarde l'ensemble de ces possibilités, finalement, les 50 additionnées font que c'est une sortie. Et donc, je pense que c'est là où on se rejoint entre les scientifiques et les enfin, moi, je suis une sorte d'artiste, hein, je suis pas... Voilà, quoi. Voilà.
Pardon. I was going to ask Cédric la question correspondante. Quelle est la sensation de... Sorry. What is the feeling... Excuse me. What is the feeling of having a movie made about your hands?
Mm-hmm. Yes. I was very surprised. I was quite surprised by the idea of Jean-Michel, but in retrospect, I thought this is natural, but it's always like this. A posteriori, you find it natural, but when you are seeing it, you say, wow, how is this? Because indeed, this hand does all the work, and it's manual activity, and we like in mathematics to use this man-made communication much more. It's much more efficient than when we have to go through electronic communication, for instance. In the book which I just handed to Paolo, which is called La Maison des Mathématiques, The House of Mathematics, it's a book which we published, me and my deputy director for the Institut Poincaré, together with a photographer who spent some time taking photographs of mathematicians working in our house. And I wrote a long introduction about the job of mathematicians, and one of the chapters I entitled The Hand, the first tool of the mathematician. Because all our thinking starts, most of our thinking starts with the hand, scribbling on scratch paper, and like prolongation of the work occurred in the brain. Of course, for this preliminary reflection, part of the time we are like this, thinking. You know, popular image of thinking is the Rodin thinker, something like this. But yes, it's a very painful position, by the way. If you try to be exactly like him, you will see that you cannot stay a long time because it hurts your knee. And really, it's not a good way to think. When you are thinking, it's rather really like this, but you look completely stupid. So it would not have been good for a statue. But then, after this stage, the right thing is to scribble something as a way to memorize, but also as a way to be some starting point, some basis for your reflection. So this, the hand does a lot of work. I also use the hand all the time when I'm listening to mathematical talks to note down what the lecturer is saying. And even if I know that I can after have the PowerPoint of the presentation or maybe the article that goes with it or whatever, I know that if I have written it somewhere, it will be better engraved in my brain somehow. So this homage to the hand, I found it remarkably well thought for homage to the mathematical work. Now, the other thing that surprised me is the amount of sensuality there is in this chalk. Sensuality? Wow, you see the chalk dancing on the blackboard, the going from the obscurity to the light. You can, because it's rich, you can make lots of interpretations, which are here or not. For instance, you can imagine that the fact that in the blackboard there are some parts which are obscure, some parts which are lit, maybe some metaphor for the fact that some parts of the proof are important and these are the ones you want to shine, and some parts of the proof are obscure. Also, notice the speck of dust of the chalk, which goes from time to time. It's a bit like an, you know, when some skater goes on the ice, and there may be some noise and a bit of the ice. Comme une course, exactly. Une course, like a race. There are the skaters and there's a little bit of the ice which goes out. And here also, and sometimes I have the impression your hand is not fast enough and you would like to go faster so that the hand can follow exactly the rhythm of the brain. And this element of speed is materialized by this speck of dust going from time to time out of the chalk. So this I like a lot, this kind of homage to the chalk. Oui, the speed, which was not so easy for the guy to keep with the camera, right? this element of speed is important for us. And at the same time, Blackboard imposes a kind of natural limit to the speed that you can do. Problem with nowadays, we have technology to do beautiful presentations with PDF, PowerPoints, or whatever. But very often in science, it goes too fast. The audience does not have the time to digest, and one and then another, etc. Blackboard puts a natural limitation to the speed that you can achieve, and this is one of the reasons why they are often more agreeable to follow. I would like also to comment on the versatility on the Blackboard, and this you see on the movie. At some point, I decide to put an arrow, to write something here, erase, put something, etc. It's much more flexible than something that would be pre-written. And usually when you start doing a proof on Blackboard like this, you don't know exactly how you will arrange things. Even if you have rehearsed, even if you know what you're going to say, you don't know exactly what's going on. Some mathematicians do their lecture with great improvisation, and they hardly know what they are going to, the words that they are going to write on the blackboard. So there's a lot of improvisation at the same time, which can go on. And also it goes well with the fact that mathematics is a field in which every time we are haunted by the number of possibilities. Jean-Michel said it about the art. So many possibilities. What will I do? What can I do to do the new piece of art, whatever? And I'd like not to make things very clear for a start and keep with some blurry image at beginning. In mathematics, we are not bound by the reality in a sense. You know, in chemistry, an experiment may work or not work. If you are a chemist, usually you try something and it doesn't work, and then you try something else and so on. But it's the nature which decides. And you have only at your disposal the elements which exist on Earth. It's a lot, but this is what exists. In mathematics, you can use elements which don't exist on Earth. You can put any law you want. You can try any theorem that you would like to try, and the possibilities are not limited by matter and nature. They are limited by logic, which is a tough constraint. But you have so many, many possible statements that you can try to work on, and it's a constant nightmare or constant problem, which is the right thing to select. First, which is the right problem? Which is the strategy of proof? Which are the logical arguments? At each step, I have like 1,000 ingredients I could try to use. Which one is it? And the only way out of this is to appeal to things like style, like example, like the elegance, like the beauty, looking for a construction which makes sense, which is elegant, which has a certain general meaning, general perspective, and so on, to help you decide through all the possibilities how to do. Otherwise, it would be just impossible if at each step of the proof you would be allowed to use any of the million possible arguments, you would never, ever make it. And here there is something within the world of mathematics. The artistic feeling, at least, is extremely well developed. And if you listen to mathematicians talking to themselves, they spend their time talking about aesthetic considerations. Like, this proof is beautiful, this argument is very pretty, this proof is completely ugly, and so on and so forth. They always repeat this. And of course, because it's in a way our only hope to find the interesting stuff in this ocean of possibilities. Every mathematician also has particular stories to talk about this. One of my very first I don't like the word important, but one of the theorems that I am proud of, one of the first ones, is theorem I proved with an Italian collaborator when I was 24 years old, something like this. And I talk about it at some point, precisely on the Cercignani conjecture.
Now you understand Portuguese as well.
Uh-huh. And I was checking some suggestion by that Italian colleague, and the suggestion was bogus. It was very naive. But doing the computation, I noticed some beautiful calculation at some point. You know, something, you are doing some calculation, and at some point where you expect everything would be kind of ugly, with no order, you recognize there is some symmetry, some order which you had not foreseen. And then you say, aha, this is too good to be useless. If there is this beautiful formula, it has to be useful. And it's something that was useful here, because indeed it was the start of the proof and the solution. Sometimes it doesn't work, but very often this is how we look for the interesting thing, by looking what looks beautiful, or at least more beautiful, more ordered, more symmetric, more elegant that you would expect.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry, I would like to know if there are some questions from the audience that you would like to ask Cédric Villani.
Okay, now I know I can tell you about partial differential equations and how they are beautiful and how they are, what's the beauty and special nature within mathematics and so on. But at the time when I chose this subject, I had no idea about all that. This choice was made, one third by chance, one third for bad reasons, one third because I was aware that it was something that it was a powerful and fastly developed field. But it was only a rather vague feeling. I knew nothing of the Boltzmann equation on which I was to do my PhD, and I went into that subject just because I was advised to and I trusted the person who advised. I was not particularly enthusiastic at physics as a high school student or even later. And I had, when I entered École Normale Supérieure, my grade in physics was a bit less than average. So it's very ironic that I, in the end, went into mathematical physics. As a student in classe préparatoire, you know, in France, there are the classe préparatoire between the end of the high school and the start of the grandes écoles, higher education schools like École Normale Supérieure. And in these 2 years of classe préparatoire, which is intense training in which you start doing serious mathematics, so to speak, it was clear that my strong field was algebra. Now it's the field that I don't understand a single word of. I'm an analyst, understanding well probability and geometry, but algebra, zero. So this shows that when you are young and starting in the business, there's hardly any way to know really what will be the field that suits you. Now I truly believe that I have the brain of an analyst, and the analyst thinking is well adapted to my way of thinking. But it was when I was, say, 19 years old, it was not clear at all. So one of the reasons why I went into analysis rather than algebra let me state it so that you can see the kind of elements of chance that make a career in the end. One of the reasons why that the course of algebra started in the first year of École Normale Supérieure a bit later than the courses of the other fields. And, you know, the start of the year was very motivated, worked hard. But after a couple of months, I decided maybe I don't need to work so hard. And after even more time, decided I could just let it go and spent most of my time listening to music and going to the concert and doing anagrams in my room. And because the algebra course was starting a bit after the other courses, I did not do anything during the algebra course. If the algebra course had started before the analysis course, maybe it would have been the contrary. That's a possibility. And after some time, I continued like this. When it was time to choose a sequel, I felt more confident to continue in analysis because I had done this preliminary work in it. That was one of the ingredients, not the only reason, but one of them. This is to show you that really depends on things which are not good reasons. And the Boltzmann equation, when I saw it, I really thought, you know, my advisor was writing it. We had a meeting in a cafe. He read the equation, and I thought, maybe it's still time to change subject. That was my thought when I see the equation written down. And you never know before you try how it will be like, all the more that the really, really serious work starts in the PhD. And the start of PhD is a kind of extremely blurred period in which you don't understand anything, what people tell you, explain you, whatever. Making sense of this chaos is the big challenge that you are facing. Now, the one good thing I'd like to mention, however, at that time of choosing my subject, for some reason I was having a crisis of motivation. This happens. It's a problem because motivation is the number one thing you need when you do research. And when you lose the motivation, you know, it's not a rational thing. There is no rational reasoning that can make you gain it again. It's like when you have your friend in nervous breakdown. Any rational argument you can give your friend will not manage to bring him up again. Motivation is here or not here. And anyway, I was going through some lack of motivation period. And because of that, I wanted to go into a subject that at least was useful. I thought, well, maybe I don't love this stuff, but at least I want to do something that will be useful for others. And partial differential equations, that's a subject which has real applications in the industry and so on. And so let's go in it. And when to my advisor, one of the first questions I asked him was, what is it good for? What is it useful for? And he explained to me that Boltzmann equation is useful, for instance, in the for aeronautics, especially high altitude. So for a space shuttle, when it goes back in the atmosphere, you have to use Boltzmann equation or a high altitude plane or whatever. And these things, I was glad that there were these applications. Now, after a few months of work on the equation, I really didn't care much that it was useful. I loved the equation for itself from that point on. And there, the motivation was back and up and very strong. Just I find it even more beautiful that it has these applications, but don't really care about them myself now. But you see the logical way these things happened. This is nice. I think Bynum of Newton and Venus of Milo are beautiful from different points of view. When you see the formula first, it's not obvious what's the beauty in there. But after some practice or some understanding, it is really a beautiful formula, that's true. In the movie, as I told you, there is no moral in the movie and various points of view, and there are several of the opinions expressed in the movie which I completely disagree with. And there are other opinions expressed in the movie which I completely agree with also, of course. About this one in particular, I don't believe that computers will soon replace mathematicians. I think, on the contrary, for still a long time to come, we'll need more mathematicians at the same time as there will be more computer theory and more computer power going into our lives. And just for the moment, one has to be aware that the computers are doing either the low-level mathematical tasks or the big, large mathematical tasks, like in the sense of big data, things that we cannot perform because we cannot proceed all the information at the same time. But in terms of arranging a proof, let's say artificial intelligence of a proof, we are absolutely nowhere for the moment. We know we start to have good programs able to check a proof. And this is this was remarkable progress. But checking a proof and making a proof, there are several orders of magnitude of difference between what this means. And precisely the problem in making a proof is get into this ocean of billions of possibilities. Checking a proof, you have just one possibility, draw an argument that you have to verify it is solid, it is sound at every place. It's much, much simpler. And it is true that one should always be extremely cautious in saying that machines will never do this or never do that. We know that in the past, everything we said about machines, like they will never beat us at chess, there was a time in which the traders, you know, doing the trade with the signs and shouting, used to say a machine will never be able to do training with the same subtlety as we do. Aha. Now, one should always be very careful when doing such predictions. So I will not say that machine will never replace the mathematician. Maybe this will arrive, but I don't believe any of us will see it in our lifetime.
Thank you very much. Thank you for coming for so short time. And we'll pursuing this conversation next year. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Paolo.